Letters of Oscar Wilde, Volume 2, 1890-1895. Exchange with the editor of the St. James's Gazette, 26th to 28th of June, 1890. From Oscar Wilde, Art and Morality, by Stuart Mason. Mr. Wilde's Bad Case. To the editor of the St. James's Gazette. Sir, I have read your criticism of my story, The Picture of Dorian Gray, and I need hardly say that I do not propose to discuss its merits and demerits, its personalities or its lack of personality. England is a free country, and ordinary English criticism is perfectly free and easy. Besides, I must admit that, either from temperament or taste, or from both, I am quite incapable of understanding how any work of art can be criticised from a moral standpoint. The sphere of art and the sphere of ethics are absolutely distinct and separate, and it is to the confusion between the two that we owe the appearance of Mrs. Grundy, that amusing old lady who represents the only original form of humour that the middle classes of this country have been able to produce. What I do object to, most strongly, is that you should have placarded the town with posters on which was printed in large letters, Mr. Oscar Wilde's latest advertisement, A Bad Case. Whether the expression, A Bad Case, refers to my book, or to the present position of the government, I cannot tell. What was silly and unnecessary was the use of the term advertisement. I think I may say without vanity, though I do not wish to appear to run vanity down, that of all men in England I am the one who requires least advertisement. I am tired to death of being advertised. I feel no thrill when I see my name in a paper. The Chronicle does not interest me any more. I wrote this book entirely for my own pleasure, and it gave me very great pleasure to write it. Whether it becomes popular or not is a matter of absolute indifference to me. I am afraid, sir, that the real advertisement is your cleverly written article. The English public, as a mass, takes no interest in a work of art until it is told that the work in question is immoral, and your réclame will, I have no doubt, largely increase the sale of the magazine, in which sale, I may mention, with some regret, I have no pecuniary interest. I remain, sir, your obedient servant, Oscar Wilde. 16 Tite Street, Chelsea, June 25th. To this, the following editorial note was appended. In the preceding column will be found the best reply which Mr. Oscar Wilde can make to our recent criticism of his mawkish and nauseous story, The Picture of Dorian Gray. Mr. Wilde tells us that he is constitutionally unable to understand how any work of art can be criticised from a moral standpoint. We were quite aware that ethics and aesthetics are different matters, and that is why the greater part of our criticism was devoted not so much to the nastiness of The Picture of Dorian Gray, but to its dullness and stupidity. Mr. Wilde pretends that we have advertised it. So we have. If any readers are attracted to a book which, we have warned them, will bore them insufferably. That the story is corrupt cannot be denied. But we added, and assuredly believe, that it is not dangerous, because, as we said, it is tedious and stupid. Mr. Wilde tells us that he wrote the story for his own pleasure, and found great pleasure in writing it. We congratulate him. There is no triumph more precious to your aesthete than the discovery of a delight which outsiders cannot share or even understand. The author of The Picture of Dorian Gray is the only person likely to find pleasure in it. Mr. Oscar Wilde again. Mr. Oscar Wilde continues to carry on the defence of his novelette, The Picture of Dorian Gray. Writing to us under yesterday's date, he says, "In your issue of today, you state that my brief letter published in your columns is the best reply I can make to your article upon Dorian Gray. This is not so. I do not propose to discuss fully the matter here, but I feel bound to say that your article contains the most unjustifiable attack that has been made upon any man of letters for many years. The writer of it, who is quite incapable of concealing his personal malice, and so in some measure destroys the effect he wishes to produce, seems not to have the slightest idea of the temper in which a work of art should be approached. To say that such a book as mine should be chucked into the fire is silly. That is what one does with newspapers. Of the value of pseudo-ethical criticism in dealing with artistic work I have spoken already, but as your writer has ventured into the perilous grounds of literary criticism, I ask you to allow me, in fairness not merely to myself, but to all men to whom literature is a fine art, to say a few words about his critical method. He begins by assailing me with much ridiculous virulence, because the chief personages in my story are puppies. They are puppies. Does he think that literature went to the dogs when Thackeray wrote about puppydom? I think that puppies are extremely interesting from an artistic as well as from a psychological point of view. They seem to me to be certainly far more interesting than prigs, and I am of the opinion that Lord Henry Wotton is an excellent corrective of the tedious ideal shadowed forth in the semi-theological novels of our age. He then makes vague and fearful insinuations about my grammar and my erudition. Now, as regards grammar, I hold that, in prose at any rate, correctness should always be subordinate to artistic effect and musical cadence, and any peculiarities of syntax that may occur in Dorian Gray are deliberately intended, and are introduced to show the value of the artistic theory in question. Your writer gives no instance of any such peculiarity. This I regret, because I do not think that any such instances occur. As regards erudition, it is always difficult, even for the most modest of us, to remember that other people do not know quite as much as one does oneself. I myself frankly admit I cannot imagine how a casual reference to Suetonius and Petronius Arbiter can be construed into evidence of a desire to impress an unoffending and ill-educated public by an assumption of superior knowledge. I should fancy that the most ordinary of scholars is perfectly well acquainted with the Lives of the Caesars and with the Satyricon. The Lives of the Caesars, at any rate, forms part of the curriculum at Oxford for those who take the Honour School of Literae Humaniores, and as for the Satyricon, it is popular even among pass men, though I suppose they are obliged to read it in translations. The writer of the article then suggests that I, in common with that great and noble artist, Count Tolstoy, take pleasure in a subject because it is dangerous. About such a suggestion there is this to be said. Romantic art deals with the exception and with the individual. Good people, belonging as they do to the normal, and so commonplace, type, are artistically uninteresting. Bad people are, from the point of view of art, fascinating studies. They represent colour, variety and strangeness. Good people exasperate one's reason. Bad people stir one's imagination. Your critic, if I must give him so honourable a title, states that the people in any story have no counterpart in life, that they are, to use his vigorous, if somewhat vulgar phrase, mere catchpenny revelations of the non-existent. Quite so. If they existed, they would not be worth writing about. The function of the artist is to invent, not to chronicle. There are no such people. If there were, I would not write about them. Life, by its realism, is always spoiling the subject matter of art. The superior pleasure in literature is to realize the non-existent. And finally, let me say this. You have reproduced, in a journalistic form, the comedy of Much Ado About Nothing, and have, of course, spoilt it in your reproduction. The poor public, hearing from an authority so high as your own that this is a wicked book that should be coerced and suppressed by a Tory government, will, no doubt, rush to it and read it. But, alas, they will find that it is a story with a moral, and the moral is this. All excess, as well as all renunciation, brings its own punishment. The painter, Basil Hallward, worshipping physical beauty far too much, as most painters do, dies by the hand of one in whose soul he has created a monstrous and absurd vanity. Dorian Gray, having led a life of mere sensation and pleasure, tries to kill conscience, and at that moment kills himself. Lord Henry Wotton seeks to be merely the spectator of life. He finds that those who reject the battle are more deeply wounded than those who take part in it. Yes, there is a terrible moral in Dorian Gray, a moral which the prurient will not be able to find in it, but it will be revealed to all whose minds are healthy. Is this an artistic error? I fear it is. It is the only error in the book. The editor added to this letter, Mr. Oscar Wilde may perhaps be excused for being angry at the remarks which we allowed ourselves to make concerning the moral tale of the three puppies and the magic picture, but he should not misrepresent us. He says we suggested that his novel was a wicked book which should be coerced and suppressed by a Tory government. We did nothing of the kind. The authors of books of much less questionable character have been proceeded against by the Treasury or the Vigilance Society, but we expressly said that we hoped Mr. Wilde's masterpiece would be left alone. Then Mr. Wilde, like any young lady who has published her first novel at the request of numerous friends, falls back on the theory of the critic's personal malice. This is unworthy of so experienced a literary gentleman. We can assure Mr. Wilde that the writer of that article had, and has, no personal malice or personal feeling towards him. We can surely censure a work which we believe to be silly, and know to be offensive, without the imputation of malice, especially when that book is written by one who is so clearly capable of better things. As for the critical question, Mr. Wilde is beating the air when he defends idealism and romantic art in literature. In the words of Mrs. Harris to Mrs. Gamp, who's denying of it? Heaven forbid that we should refuse to an author the supreme pleasure of realizing the non-existent, or that we should judge the aesthetic from the purely ethical standpoint. No, our criticism starts from lower ground. Mr. Wilde says that his story is a moral tale, because the wicked persons in it come to a bad end. We will not be so rude as to quote a certain remark about morality which one Mr. Charles Surface made to Mr. Joseph Surface. We simply say that every critic has the right to point out that a work of art or literature is dull and incompetent in its treatment, as the picture of Dorian Gray is, and that its dullness and incompetence are not redeemed because it constantly hints, not obscurely, at disgusting sins and abominable crimes, as the picture of Dorian Gray does. Mr. Oscar Wilde's defence. To the editor of the St. James's Gazette, Sir, as you still keep up, though in a somewhat milder form than before, your attacks on me and my book, you not only conferred upon me the right, but you impose on me the duty of reply. You state, in your issue of today, that I misrepresented you when I said that you suggested that a book so wicked as mine...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.